I'm delighted to now moderate this second session, the first session of today, following, I think, a very good opening session, very well moderated by Paul Gillespie. We, I think, set out the broader parameters of the Sustainable Development Goals and had a very interesting discussion linking with Brexit and being very up to date on it. We saw that the symposium is very timely because there will be the first review of the 22 countries that are volunteering to be the first in line for that later this month in New York at the High Level Political Forum, which runs from, I think it's the 11th to the 20th of July. I'll be there for the high level segment of it from the 18th to the 20th, and I know Heather will be there and possibly other members of our panels. You can imagine I'm really happy to be moderating this particular session because it's on a subject that is a passion to me since I had to grow up with those four brothers here in Ballina and at an early stage had to use my elbows and generally assert. Goal five is an interesting goal in a way because it's so much stronger than gender is in the climate world. There was a clear determination to have a separate goal and to have gender mainstreamed in the Sustainable Development Goals. It was a completely different conversation from our struggle to get gender into the climate negotiations. We had got gender balance into the into the UN FCCC in Doha by women leaders literally being determined to do that, and we called it the Doha miracle. We got gender. But in the Paris Agreement, it was extremely difficult. There is no article about gender. There's no strong thing. Gender is there, and gender responsive is mentioned, but it was a real struggle. And so, you know, in the development world, people understand the importance of gender equality. I'm afraid in the climate world, it's still even more of a struggle. So that's just an interesting perspective to start with. So now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Geraldine Fraser-Molekti. As I mentioned last night, Geraldine and I ran into each other at the African Development Bank meeting in Zambia more recently, but we have interacted over the years, and you're not only the gender advisor to the African Development Bank, I think you're somebody who really understands, in a very developed sense, the importance of gender, the importance of empowerment, the importance of women and girls. And so I have great pleasure, Geraldine, in inviting you to speak. And I think you're going to make a presentation. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, great. Can you see from there? Because if necessary, you can go down if you like. Yeah.
Come up again.
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. As you can see, I'm not the tallest, so this may just not meet me in the nose. I think that's there. If you can hear me, that's what matters. So good morning, and it's good to be here, Mary, and good to be here with, I wish to use the term, an alumni of people who have walked this path over a number of decades. You know, some may have joined it more recently, but one that looks at how we'll ensure that the struggles to ensure that gender equality does have the importance and maintains the importance it requires, that it remains on the global agenda. And if we want that to really happen, then whether we like it or not, financing it matters. And I'm going to take you through a bit of a presentation that will take you through a journey in the African Development Bank. And I do so, and it's quite timeous that we do it here, because Mary also happens to be part of a high-level panel for the African Development Bank that's looking into the direction of the bank as it moves forward at this critical moment. I put up this particular slide that reflects on the billions to trillions, because this was the commitment made by multilateral development banks at the Financing for Development Summit 3. And this particular commitment very clearly put an amount on the table, where there was a figure, I think, of something like $400 billion that the development finance institutions said that they would invest over this period. Now, if we look at that particular amount, I mean, really in the implementation of the SDGs, this is definitely not going to be sufficient. But I think what we need to do is look at how we can use resources that are available to invest in an agenda that matters. So I've also reflected the links between Agenda 2063 of the African Union and a commitment to the Africa we want. And I think it should be borne in mind that when we met at the high-level summit to reach an agreement on Agenda 2030, Africa had an Africa Common Platform on the SDGs, and that, mind you, was one that was achieved and attained under the stewardship of President Ellen Sirleaf Johnson, and civil society clearly played a role in that. The African Development Bank at this point in time has committed itself to what it refers to as the High Five. The five issues: light up and power Africa, feed Africa, integrate Africa, industrialize Africa, and improve the quality of life for Africa's people. Now, if women don't ensure that the lights are switched on in Africa, we won't have an inclusive agenda to achieve what's required with Agenda 2063, with the SDGs, and Agenda 2030, or any other commitment we've set ourselves. So just to ensure that gender equality remains on the agenda and is there and is resourced, but above all, that women are seen as central in so doing as well. So the ADB itself looked at investing in gender equality for Africa's transformation. And in our 10-year strategy, we had twin objectives of inclusive growth and transition to green growth. But it didn't. The bank itself did not have a gender strategy that clearly took this forward, and we adopted that strategy through the board in January of 2014. And the strategy has three pillars: strengthening women's legal status and property rights, promoting women's economic empowerment, because we also, in addition to ensuring that the normative and rights agenda is central, we feel that women will have more voice as they have choice, and we need to ensure that we have the promotion of women's economic empowerment on the agenda. But as Nolene had pointed out yesterday, we shouldn't let others usurp the agenda. So we are not going to have institutions and stakeholders usurping it. Women need to drive it. And of course, the knowledge management and capacity development is key in taking the sustainable development agenda forward. So I just want to touch on very quickly what over a two-year period, as the African Development Bank, what we did and we saw as trends. And trends that indicates that we must make the SDGs attainable, and it can be. We spent 9.8 million spent resources to ensure that 9.8 million women have improved access to resources. This is the population of at least four countries: the Gambia, we see Rwanda, and so on. But this impact reflects that if we have the right drive and we have the global support required, the SDGs can be attainable. But as you indicated yesterday, for this, It requires a huge social movement. We need to have governments not only making commitments to the SDGs, and hence what Mary pointed out earlier, the fact that the first voluntary review will take place later this month is so critical. It's the doing, and civil society must be part of the larger social movement to make a difference, because these numbers, much as it may be seen as significant, we have a long way to go. And we have a long way to go to ensure that women on the continent are not seen as the trickle-down beneficiaries, but that there's a real difference where the girls and boys on our continent will form part of the transformed Africa required. We have also, in the process, through our African Development Fund of the ADB, invested in operations across about 10 sectors. And this is across various countries, ranging from the Horn of Africa to the Sahel, and going down to Mozambique. Essentially fragile countries, but I'd also want to say that there's no more stable democracy that can see itself as not being subject to fragility. The largest economy on the African continent, Nigeria, second largest Egypt, and third South Africa, has very clearly shows that there are challenges in countries that are considered more developed, that are seen to have larger economies, and yet they have fragility. Who knows, as we look across the strait, we may have to provide fragile support going forward, for all that we know. That was on a lighter note on Brexit. So the support for fragile situations, some of the projects that were there ranged from the drought resilience and sustainable livelihoods program that we run in the Horn of Africa. And mind you, this is not a gender equality program. There's a 15-year program, development program across the Horn that is targeting drought. And there's a range of, a sort of multiplicity of interventions. And in terms of that program, we said, and when I came in, I said, we're going to follow the money in the bank. We don't want gender equality to be seen as that add-on. Mm. That's done by the Special Envoy's Office and the Division on Gender Equality. It's got to be in the core operations of the bank. It's got to be in the infrastructure complex, which is the largest complex in the bank. And hence, I looked at the Drought Resilience Program. That's a multi-million project. It's more than $300 million over a period of 10 to 15 years with partners. And we said that's where we want to be. Because if you look at vulnerability of girls and women, girls being pulled out of school at an early age, if you look at global insecurity and the fact that there are young men who have no choices, this is where we need to intervene. And we've intervened. And Dana, who's here with me, has actually worked on that project. And we can talk further about it. But I am running short of time and want to go on. So many say that you can't really have a more gender-responsive infrastructure. And Diane may well disagree and say, but there can be a feminist approach to infrastructure, but many want to say it can't happen. And we've shown through the Ghana Fufuli Salwa Road and Community Development Project that connects two large cities in the north of Ghana, but also connects Ghana with neighboring countries like Cote d'Ivoire and so on. This particular road project, through community engagement, actually took a more holistic approach. This part of the country is where the largest percentage of guinea worm cases are. Since the building of that road, it has dropped considerably because there's more potable water in that area. There's feeder roads that link one of the smaller cities with Tamale, and where it took people 4 hours to reach the hospital in Tamale, it now takes them an hour. Less women die in childbirth because they could get to a hospital faster. We haven't solved all the problems in this area, and I don't want it to be seen that we've solved it. But it clearly shows that infrastructure investment, if appropriately designed, can make a huge difference. And hence our commitment on SDG 5 is ensure that the money that's available reaches everyone, that it is inclusive financing, and just don't just give us the separate project. The Kenya Menangai geothermal project is a green project, and I'm not going to read what's stated there. So in terms of the money and getting resources and looking at innovative financing, and again, we don't have the silver, or least of all, we don't have a platinum bullet yet, but we've looked at the need to ensure that women are in the African economic value chain, and there's some data on the table. We've also looked at the market and financial gap that says that women's participation in business averages over 25% across the African continent. And we have, through drawing on research that's been done, I mean, it's very clear that in terms of the finance gap for women in business, it's $42 billion. The major barriers to access to finance, and many of you are aware of it, and it's simply being emphasized, is that women business is considered too risky by commercial banks, and even by the MDBs, you know. There are high loan interest rates and so on. And yet there's evidence through research that was done that women repay loans better than men do. So the incumbent president of the African Development Bank, Dr. Adesina, made an announcement in October last year and said that as the bank, we are going to put in place affirmative financing action for Women in Africa program that has a clear objective to unleash women's economic potential through financial intermediaries that will enable women's business to access finance. That's a triple A in a different sense: accessible, affordable, and available. And as the bank, we're going to raise $300 million for to leverage $3 billion for financing. Ambitious, but if we're not ambitious and audacious on this agenda or on the SDG 5 agenda, we're not going to achieve the SDGs and we won't achieve SDG 5. So there is a financing window that's being put in place that will catalyze and direct debt financial resources to financial intermediaries and amongst others. There's also a technical assistance window that will have about up to 30% of the overall fund for technical assistance, and it will focus on providing products for women MSMEs and other financial institutions requiring assistance to direct such products. And it's quite good that Rockefeller speaks after me in terms of needs that are there. We also intend to use this facility to create a more enabling business environment. And the intention...
That always falls down, don't worry.
The intention with this is not... is to ensure that it's not just about financing, but that it's more holistic. And this will be done with partners. It's not the bank doing it on its own. And then the fourth pillar is an empowerment lab This is where innovation should take place, and where we encourage innovation, where we encourage the development of a digital marketplace for women, and there's one in the making of which for which the ADB has set aside $10 million, and it will come to the board later this month. But the expected outcome will consist of increased financial services for women, women-owned enterprises, revenue growth for women-owned enterprises, accessing new financing, job creation, economic empowerment, and impact will be measured by specific gender performance indicators, and so on. So overall, we see AFAWA as contributing towards making a difference. We have high expectations as women on the continent. We have high expectations as women globally. And we want to stop at nothing short of audaciousness. So as we go into the assessment of the attainment of SDG 5, hold the feet of the MDBs to the fire that made the commitment at FFD3 to ensure that there'll be clear financing going towards the SDGs, but ensure that in that financing, that SDG 5 is not seen as the add-on and the nice to have, that it is part, that the financing in all the SDGs mainstream gender, but that above all, that there is the required access to funding. And it's a high-level panel of the SG that's looking at women's empowerment, economic empowerment, also needs to engage with us as regional finance institutions, as we engage with the financial service sector, in order to ensure that there's a reconsideration on how they view risk, how collateral is viewed, and women's collateral is viewed. It's not going to be easy, because we need to work on how we deal with filters that won't make this environment complex and yet not create too much of a challenge in the larger financial services sector. Because at the end of the day, we will light up Africa, we will feed Africa, we will industrialize Africa, we will improve the quality of life of all Africans, and we'll integrate Africa. Because at the end of the day, in 2030, and most likely in 2060, we'd like Africans to look back and think that the challenges that they are confronting at present and have confronted to date is just something that their parents talk about, that their lives will look different, and that for girls, the STEM sector is the normal. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Geraldine. That was a very stimulating presentation. And I have a favor to ask you. As you mentioned, I'm on the high-level panel of the African Development Bank. Would you ever send me your PowerPoint so I can help you to keep that bank on course? But it's good that there is that level of planning and integration. What I would like to do is to invite both Heather and Nolene to maybe just comment on Geraldine's presentation, and then I'll invite you, Heather, to come and make your own presentation. But I think it'd be nice to just get the two of you to give a quick reaction. We will discuss later, but just while it's in your minds.
I think for me, the most important point is that gender and women's equality has to be central to the workings of all of the multilateral development institutions. As long as it's an add-on, it's not really going to make enough of a difference. So I really applaud your trying to take it in that direction, and I think too few people are leaning into that, as they say. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Nolene?
Yeah, very short. When I was the head of the Economic and Social Commission, I worked very closely with the Asian Development Bank. And it was very much along the same lines, because they were had a huge portfolio on infrastructure. Yeah. And unless we actually look at where their money is going and really make sure that they understand how to use that money in order to move the gender equality, women's empowerment agenda, it's not going to automatically happen. Yeah. And I am very, very pleased that all the banks are now moving from billion to trillions.
Thank you. Okay, thank you both. I just wanted to get that immediate response to Geraldine's presentation. And now it gives me great pleasure to call on Heather Grady to make her presentation. Heather, as I mentioned yesterday, is a close personal friend. She came from a senior position in Asia, actually, for Oxfam, to work with my small organization at that time called Realizing Rights, working on economic and social rights in African countries. And somehow she adjusted very well from a big organization like Oxfam to a very small organization that tried to be nimble and work and became our managing director. And then I was delighted that she became vice president of the Rockefeller Foundation as a whole for a number of years. And now she is vice president of another part of Rockefeller, if you like, Rockefeller Philanthropy Advisors. As far as I know, she advises very rich people on how to spend their money well. That's my understanding of it. But anyway, so Heather, over to you.
Thank you, Mary. As Nolene said yesterday, when Mary calls, we come.
So I've been asked to focus on the, particularly on the role of philanthropy in supporting SDG 5 and gender equality. I just want to say I'm delighted to be speaking about this in particular. I've been involved in women's rights since my mother, Regina Grady, was dragging me to women's rights demonstrations on the streets of my hometown of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So always a pleasure to work on this area. First, let me start by defining what I mean by the philanthropy sector. I mean voluntary private giving for public good. And here most of my data will be about institutional philanthropy, mostly in the form of first, endowed foundations with their own financial engine. Second, community foundations who both take in and give out money. Third, donor-advised funds and trusts. Fourth, corporate foundations and their philanthropy. And fifth, newer forms of philanthropic investing like impact investing. In other words, investing for a financial return, but also social or environmental benefit. There are other forms of community philanthropy. All of us, I think, do charitable giving, but I won't focus on those today in the data. Taking the philanthropic institution of the foundation alone, there are more than 90,000 in the United States, more than 110,000 in Europe, and a growing number in emerging markets around the world. Philanthropy has been key to promoting women's rights and empowerment over the last decades. Many surveys on philanthropic giving, though, don't segment giving to women and girls as a distinct category. So this makes calculating the amount and presumed growth of such giving difficult to estimate. And there's an argument to be made that in the SDGs period, we should start to disaggregate that data better. But the Association for Women in Development, AWID, did extensive studies over on this subject over the past decade, and I'll draw from their data, as well as newly compiled data from the New York-based Foundation Center, and they joined with us in an initiative launched by my organization, Rockefeller Philanthropy Advisors, and the UN Development Program, UNDP, called the SDG Philanthropy Platform. The purpose of this is to get philanthropy more engaged in the SDGs. Between 1990 and 2006, funding from from foundations in the United States, for example, for women and girls grew at a faster rate than foundation giving as a whole. The annual number was about US $412 million in 1990. By 2006, a decade and a half later, was about $2.1 billion. Adjusted for inflation, this is growth of 223%, while overall foundation giving rose by 177%. Many people believe that the Beijing Women's Conference and strength in the international women's movement really supported that shift. But nevertheless, by the end of that period, only around 8% of overall foundation giving was specifically for women and girls. I apologize, these slides are a bit light and some of the print is small. You may have trouble seeing at the back, but if anyone's interested, I can share it later. Yesterday we spoke mainly about the SDGs, but as Mary and others mentioned, their precursor was the Millennium Development Goals, the MDGs, from 2001 to 2015. Did having an MDG 3 on gender equality make a difference? The goal was to promote gender equality and empower women, and its specified target was to eliminate gender disparity in education. The world as a whole has generally reached that target, although quality and education outcomes remain a big problem. There were big gains for women represented in parliaments, which almost doubled, but still enormous gaps in poverty, employment, and leadership. Was philanthropy influenced by having MDG Goal 3? Not really. What we know from experience is that where there was foundation leadership on a particular goal, working collaboratively with governments, the private sector, and civil society, large gains were made. And examples of that are in HIV/AIDS and tackling malaria. That didn't happen with MDG Goal 3. But MDGs aside, during that period, what kind of activities did those billions of dollars of funding support? According to a study by the Foundation Center and the Women's Funding Network in 2009, foundation giving for women and girls primarily supported health-related activities, including family planning. We know that women's rights organizations, who were key players in fighting gender inequality, have had nowhere near the amount of resources and consistent funding support needed to truly accomplish that MDG. And unless we do things differently, they won't have enough to achieve SDG, Sustainable Development Goal 5. A 2006 report by AWID notes that mainstreaming women's rights and integrating gender equality into organizations and programs after the mid-1990s, didn't have the consequence of strengthening action in respect to women's rights. Instead, it often meant reducing the number of gender equality specialists and women-specific programs, for example. In this first year of the SDGs, then, what can we learn from the last decade of philanthropy by and about women? Have women's organizations, especially the ones at the local level, gotten the support they need, or must we continue to remedy a problem? On the positive side, there was growth in the size of women's funds between 2005 and 2010 of close to 60%. Growth from official development assistance was only 4% in that period. The rest was from private sources. But in fact, women's organizations continue to be significantly under-resourced. An AWID global survey in 2010 found in their sample of 740 women's organizations, they had a median annual income of just US $20,000. One of the best routes to get funding to women's local organizations is through these women's funds, but these too are small. This slide from AWID's 2010 study identified 42 funds whose combined income was about $55 million. The largest funds in terms of income, not surprisingly, were in the US and Europe. And two examples are Mama Cash and the Global Fund for Women. But most have very little resources. 57% of those funds only have US $500,000 or less in 2010. Philanthropy support lacks long-term consistency. The grants are too short-term. We're not giving enough support over a long enough period of time. So let's turn to this ambitious agenda for gender equality, primarily but not exclusively expressed in Sustainable Development Goal 5. Here are the targets. It's a fairly comprehensive approach. End discrimination, end violence and harmful practices. There are targets on recognizing unpaid work, on women's leadership. Targets on access to sexual and reproductive health and reproductive rights. The use of enabling technology. And targets in other goals, like full and productive employment for all women and men, equal pay for equal work, and targets related to environment and climate change for women. This agenda, in my view, requires strong women-led organizations in every country around the world, pushing this agenda from the local to the national level, holding governments accountable in their own countries. In a sustained approach over the next 15 years, it requires working closely with government policymakers so they move from commitments to implementation, as we were discussing yesterday. Is that what philanthropy has been funding? In fact, the majority of women-led organizations remain quite small because they cannot mobilize the resources that they need. In a 2013 study by AWID called New Actors, New Money, New Conversations, they found that of 170 initiatives focused on women and girls around the world, only 27% of them actually engaged women's organizations as partners, and only 9% directly funded them. Private foundation interest in women and girls is growing, which is great. But most of that increase is attributed to a few mega funders, such as the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the majority is still spent in the United States or distributed to large international NGOs, seldom to women's local organizations. Musimbi Kanyoro, a friend of mine and a friend of Mary's, she's head of the Global Fund for Women, one of the most important institutions for women's philanthropy. She said, "Never before has there been a moment like this where there is a real possibility to substantially change power relations between men and women. It's time for bold moves. We have an opportunity to do things differently in this SDGs period, to work on gender equality and women's empowerment with a more systemic approach. But philanthropy needs to be a greater part of it. The SDGs do present an opportunity for this sector to coalesce around a globally agreed normative framework, one that incorporates an explicit focus on women and girls, addressing inequality, promoting inclusive societies, and leaving no one behind. And for the first time, the broader philanthropy sector has been invited in by the UN and by governments as stakeholders. Fortunately, there is growing interest by the philanthropy sector in the SDGs to use them as a reference point in their giving, create collaborations around the goals and targets of interest, and more consistently report philanthropic spending according to the goals. Is our sector up to the task? Data on philanthropy in the SDGs is still being compiled for these years, but the Foundation Center has coded millions of grants from the period 2010 to 2013 to the SDGs, which are shown on the website of our SDG philanthropy platform called sdgfunders.org, and I would invite you to look at and use that website. What we learn about those funding patterns and what we can predict based on this can help to set the path for the next 15 years. Of all the philanthropic funding tracked for those years, and this is mainly data from the US and Europe, about 8% of it went to Goal 5, or about US $8.2 billion. The chart also shows that there were high concentrations spent in North America and Africa. Over this five-year period, foundations had a gradual upswing for funding in Goal 5, as opposed to official development assistance, which had a gradual decrease. The Foundation Center codes data by funder, by country the grant is made to, and by recipients. SDGfunders.org has very detailed information, but I've just pulled some here, the top line information. For example, the top eight foundation givers to Goal 5 in this period are the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation at $1.4 billion, the Susan Thompson Buffett Foundation at just over $1 billion, through and including the Ford Foundation, the big lottery fund of the UK, the Hewlett Foundation, Comic Relief UK, the Novo Foundation, and coming in eighth is the Packard Foundation based out in the Bay Area where I am, at about $124 million. The list of destinations for this funding is on the right side of the slide. It's also illuminating. The seven countries ranking highest are the US, UK, India, Mexico, Nigeria, Kenya, and Ethiopia. The recipient organizations are perhaps even more interesting. The US NGO PATH received the most at about $295 million. The next two were also US organizations, PSI and Planned Parenthood, averaging about $216 million over that period. Next were the National Abortion Federation, Marie Stopes International, IPAS, and DKT. What do you notice about all of these? Yes. Health and family planning. This reaffirms what AWID had noted years earlier, that much of the funding for women and girls is in this area. Is this concentration on funding in this area and a very strong bias toward US organizations a good or bad move on the part of philanthropy? Certainly all of the recipients are credible and good organizations, no question. But thinking back to what creates sustained women's empowerment, the need to get to the grassroots, to influence policymaking, to hold governments account around the world to the SDG commitments they've made, we should perhaps focus more on national, not international group, on women-led organizations. Looking back at an AWID chart from a 2010 study, look at what issue areas are funded by the 37 women funds. In their survey, a very different picture: economic, social, and cultural rights, gender-based violence, women's economic empowerment, women's leadership and political participation, as well as the very important reproductive rights, health and sexual health. And in essence, all of the targets in Goal 5. The philanthropy sector might wish to take note of a comment from that report that even with the presence of women and girls as a priority in almost every funding sector, the core elements of a sustainable long-term struggle for transforming the institutions and structures that perpetuate discrimination and exclusion are considered too slow and difficult to measure, and therefore receive little or no support, except from a handful of insightful and experienced donors. The target population of those 37 women's funds is also instructive. They're shown here. They're aimed at, in order, grassroots leaders, community leaders, indigenous women, women health providers, ethnic and cultural minorities, women living in rural areas, and LGBT leaders. I would argue that for foundation leaders, being intentional about who we're giving to is very important. And I'd like to turn just briefly to the whole area of women and market-led interventions for change and finance, where there's a lot of debate. AWID and some others have criticized the emphasis on women's economic empowerment because it's too often narrowly defined as support for small entrepreneurs or microfinance activities. And to some extent, this is true. Many of these activities never get at the structural causes of poverty. How should philanthropy respond in the SDG era? The reality is that a growing proportion of foundations and philanthropists believe in the power of markets and finance to solve today's most complex problems, often because of the failure of governments and politicians to do so, in areas ranging from creating employment to healthcare to access to energy to sustainable water systems. And true, too, is that the price tag of the SDGs is estimated at somewhere around $4 trillion a year until 2030, which simply can't be paid for by government and philanthropy alone. We have to fundamentally change market systems so that more of the world's finance is going into social finance, and a growing proportion of world's business is directed to providing social and economic and environmental benefit, not just financial return. Philanthropy can influence this. I personally want to see, and I do see, women in the forefront of this movement, both as impact investors and as business leaders, from tiny micro entrepreneurs to global business leaders. The expansion of women's wealth is an enormous opportunity. With the expected intergenerational transfer of wealth of up to $40 trillion in the near future, women will inherit and spend even more money. I want them to understand what Goal 5 is and to support women's fairer participation in our economic systems, better social policies around the world, better, more equal pay, and also to promote the other aspects of gender equality in this goal. This slide illustrates just a small selection of who is giving by and for women. It includes long-standing women's funds, as well as many new initiatives and individual women who will be a growing part of achieving Goal 5 and all the SDGs. I want to end by saying that the real work begins now. The SDG goals, targets, and indicators have benefited enormously from more than 3 years of consultation and negotiation. This year, every country is expected to finalize or draft a plan to achieve the SDGs. To get philanthropy to play its part most effectively, we must do a few things. First, our global goal on gender equality should help us to tie together the many disparate strands of philanthropic funding so that women's giving is better documented, better prioritized, and we take a more systems-level approach. We not only have to raise more funds, but spend more wisely. We have to push governments to strengthen gender equality in their national SDG plans, and keep reminding ourselves that women's empowerment is an accelerator for all of the goals. We have to tackle the bottlenecks, financial or institutional, and really look for what catalyzes change. And philanthropy has to get out of its silo and work better and more with other sectors. This will bring transformative change that is substantive, sustainable, and irreversible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. thankfully, were equally kind of broadly conscious and, you know, want to drive transformative change through the role and agency of women. And women, and I thought that was a very good common thread. Before I ask both Geraldine and Nolene to just comment on Heather's presentation, as I did in relation to Geraldine's earlier, I just want to say, you know, I'm looking at the audience here. I'm very pleased to see that we have a reasonably good gender balance. We have a significant number of men in the room, and that is really important because gender equality is not a women's issue. Yeah. It is an issue for broad, balanced societies that become more equal and fairer and more socially balanced and everything else. So I just want to register a particular welcome to the men in the room as well to help us to get this gender equality goal really achieved. Yeah. So Nolene first maybe and then Geraldine. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Heather. I thought that was really brilliant. Thank you. You know, it brings me back to a point when just before I joined KUNIFEM, I was involved with helping with the grassroots, very much at the grassroots level. And it really was very hurtful that they had to raise resources through what I call bake sales. I mean, really, it was so small, it was so much work to in order to get the work done. And when I looked at where the main budgets were going, it was going to defense. So we tried to turn the whole thing around by saying, what a different world we will have if the military and the defense sector had to raise their funds through bake sales and women had the biggest share. I think we would have a very different world. And therefore, just to end by saying that I think now we have to think in terms of the ecosystems that make change and all the way from the global to the local. And really, at the end of the day, the local is where the real life work has to happen, and that's where there's something that we must never forget. And thank you for bringing that up.
Thank you, Nolene. Geraldine?
Yeah. Thank you very much. I think, Eva, this is really excellent, and I think it also shows, as in the input that I've made, that we need to look at what is the big picture and what's the overall commitment. And as I had indicated in the commitment that came from the multilateral banks, and they said there's a need to move from billions to trillions, they made a commitment of $400 billion to the implementation of the SDGs. But I think when you unpack it, the story is very different. So I think if from all sides, public sector, private sector, civil society, we look at the story and say we're going to follow the money. We must make sure that the money reaches where it should and that SDG 5 must be made a reality. The second point that you raised, and it is quite a challenge because when we look at where the women are, they tend to be at the bottom of the pyramid, but we can't let the financing be microfinancing that will never raise them out of the bottom of the pyramid. So we've got to, as you've indicated, we've got to take it forward and say, this is our opportunity, and this is the 15 years for impact at all levels of the pyramid. And let's ensure resources are available. Mm. Last point, and it's a bit of a difficult one. We've looked at where money has gone for women, and you've pointed out that it's largely been in health and reproductive health. And if I think of Niger, we still need that money there. Yeah. When I look at Mali, we need that money there. But we've got to be holistic because it's also got to be money in education and women in education. It's got to be money that's going to help women grow in the private sector and all. So at the end of the day, it's been too little before, and now we need to make sure that it's not too little too late for the future.
Thank you very much indeed. I see that Emer Gilvary, who is the chair of the foundation that runs the Mary Robinson Centre, has just arrived down from Dublin. Welcome, Emer. Good to see you. And now I have great pleasure in introducing again, in the sense that she spoke at the opening session last night, Nolene Hazer. I think you roused people very well last night, Nolene, so please rouse them again. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. I thought that the two presentations were just absolutely brilliant, and thank you very much for getting us off the road. Indeed, if we are talking about implementation, there's no way in which we can do implementation without financial support. And therefore, to follow the money is absolutely critical. And if we look, I was very much involved with the Fourth World Conference on Women, and if you look at the implementation there, it was very uneven. So promises made are never promises kept. And it's always because there's not enough money. And even when people talked about mainstreaming as a big agenda, what did they do? I was absolutely horrified when I realized that what you were talking about in terms of mechanisms of implementation, you were talking about gender focal points. So all over, small, underpowered, really, it was almost like to give you the illusion that something was happening, but it was never quite happening because you didn't have the power, you didn't have the voice. And in fact, what was created was actually competition among the women to get that little bit of money that was trickling down. So it was not meant, I'm sure this was not a strategy of distraction, but it worked as that. So we have to be extremely careful that we don't repeat that again. Then when I went to UNIFEM, again, the UN had a wonderful United Nations Development Fund for women. And I was horrified within 2 weeks to find that the fund was in deficit. and eventually, of course, we were able to turn that around. And it was a big struggle because, again, when they talked about mainstreaming, when they found that the fund was in deficit, it was to get rid of the fund because everybody else can do the big work. So the big organization could do the work. And of course, I fought like crazy because I said, if you look at the whole system without the heart and the soul and the group that can mobilize the voice, the partnerships, to be able to make sure that there's great accountability in the whole system, is not going to work. Eventually, I won, but with a very tough fight. But without that fight, we would not actually today have what the type of work we have, even in the United Nations system. And I say that because eventually we were able not just to look at the development sector, Goal 5, but also Goal 16. I mean, the whole peace development agenda, and of course the work on fragile states. But that I wanted to show and to change the narrative of what I meant by gender mainstreaming. And what I did was I looked at the map of power in the whole UN system, and of course it was Security Council. And of course the largest money, billions of dollars, is going to the peacekeeping. And therefore that was where I went in. And everyone said, shouldn't you be actually talking about the grassroots women? Why are you here? And I said, because your action affect the grassroots women, and the grassroots women from the conflict-affected countries will be pulled together to speak to you as to why you need to change. So that was how we actually got 1325. And the whole peacekeeping, peace-building agenda changed. And for me, that was gender mainstreaming. I say this because today I'm actually very pleased, because when I look at the review of the peacekeeping architecture, there are now three big studies that have been done. So one was, of course, on peacekeeping itself. The other one was on peace building. And the third was women, peace, and security. In 2000, when we did that Security Council resolution, I would never have thought it would be brought to the same level. And of course, I mean, there's still so much work to be done. What I'm saying, the story that I'm telling, is the fact that we need to control the narrative. And we need to be the one to show how it can be done, and then to pull everybody into the framework of accountability. If we don't do that, the agenda will be stolen by somebody else, and they will define it. So you can imagine, if I just look at the mainstreaming agenda, from the gender focal points, all the little bits, to the main action. And of course, as I was doing that, I realized that UNIFEM itself was in a really difficult position because it didn't have enough power to jump in at the top policy making table. And then it didn't, and it's so much dependent on the personality of who the executive director would be. And so the idea of institutionalizing it and to change the gender architecture in the UN system itself became a big struggle, and then that's how we worked and got UN Women at the level of the Under Secretary General. But I think the partnerships, so then later on I went to become an Under Secretary General myself at the Economic and Social Commission, and I realized how much easier it was. It was so much easier because I had the power. And I had the power to partner with a bank. I had the power to call the heads of states. I had endless power, and I was just pleased with the power that I have. I'm so sorry. I'm not power crazy, but I... but really, I enjoyed it. And I had so much... I couldn't believe how much power I had. But at the end of the day, I was able to get Asia to rethink itself, and of course the whole journey is still there, the bang is still there, but I tell the story because I think that power to women is really critical. But when we have power, we need to make sure that that power is used not as power over, but as power based on the principles, the values, and we're able to actually mobilize the whole constituency. And this time round, the constituency has to be even much larger. If we are really to get this agenda off the ground, it's not just about governments. We have already talked yesterday about the governments, how they have to be more accountable. But today I just want to say, I think that a lot more people have got to be accountable, mainly the private sector. I think the idea that it is, when you talk about private sector, it can no longer be how you spend money. It has to be how you make your money. And you have to make your money respecting workers' rights, women's rights, having a sense of what it means to have sustainability. I think the whole issue of governance of the private sector has got to become, have to come back in a big way, so that it is at the core strategy of how you generate wealth. I think the other thing that we need to do is to realize that we cannot allow our financial system to be so ungovernable as it is today. Because what happens to our financial systems, the type of decisions that are made there, have affected the real economy. And we can no longer allow our huge, huge, huge flow of financial resources, the trillions of dollars that go around the casino economy, to go without any accountability. We cannot have the tax havens which we have. Because the governments, if we are to raise these trillions of dollars, we have to make sure where is the money coming from. The world is at its richest today. It is at its richest, but unfortunately, it is also at its most unequal. And therefore, by balancing the resources, by making sure that the asset base is much better shared, we can make a big difference. So I think the sustainability agenda that put people and planet at the forefront will actually make that big difference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nolene. I think you introduced a very relevant dimension, even though we're talking about gender equality, which is that the private sector has to be accountable. And we have actually a framework for that, which was unanimously endorsed by the Human Rights Council some years ago in 2006, and that is the framework of the UN Guiding Principles,
yes,
which
absolutely.
Says that all governments have a responsibility to protect their people from violations of the human rights by corporations. So that's the first part of it. Secondly, all corporations have a duty to respect all human rights. So the governments have to protect. The responsibility of corporations is less, but it's there to respect all human rights. And in working that through, the respect is not just a passive, not knowing. It is a due diligence respect, and they must know what's happening in the supply chains, etc. Mm. And thirdly, we need better remedies, not just court remedies, though they're important, but also remedies that are effective to manage situations. And, and at all three levels, there's a working group that's working on those. But it is important that we have, again, we have the framework. Yes. Implementation is another matter. But I'd again like to invite both Geraldine and Heather to respond to what I'm sorry, I responded myself, but to respond to what Nolene said. Geraldine, start with you.
Yeah, I heard power relations and the importance of being at the centre of power if we want to take SDG 5 forward, wherever that is, public sector, private sector, or in the multilateral institutions and so on. Secondly, accountability. And Mary, you spoke about it, so I'm not going to elaborate. The accountability came through. Thirdly, I also heard the issue about the importance of funds and earmarked funds in instances, but it shouldn't be seen outside of a larger ecosystem. So if I look at the affirmative financing action for women in Africa, it's not just a fund for women, a 300 million to generate 3 billion. It's also about looking at the larger enabling environment it should create in the financial services sector through technical assistance, through innovation and an empowerment lab. So these are some of what I pull out. There's many more one can raise.
Thank you. Heather.
Yeah, I have two thoughts. First, this point you brought up about having grassroots level women talk to those in the highest halls of power. I think that's a very important point, in that not only for SDG 5, but for all of the SDGs, it's very important that we build that accountability process. The local is the global, and the global is the local. And this, and the powerful and the powerless, we have to really bridge that divide and equalize it. And the second thing I just thought about is this point about the private sector. Maybe not all of us can give away 5,000 euros every year. We're not that wealthy, but we spend at least 5,000 euros per year. And I think we should think a lot more about what we're doing with our consumer power and how that can support women. Mary and I are both affiliated with a group called the Business and Human Rights Resource Center. You can look on their site and see how are the companies that we buy things from all the time, how are they treating their workers? How are they treating women in their supply chains? How are they treating women and men in local communities where they work? I think we can activate that a lot more as a part of all of us helping the world to achieve these goals.
Thank you, Heather. Now, I think we've had three really high quality presentations, very thoughtful, very thought-provoking. We only have 20 minutes left for this session, and I want to open it to the floor, because when it was opened last night, we had some really thoughtful questions or comments. So if you don't want to, I've got loads of questions in my brain. So I could keep this panel going all on my own, but I just want to have this more interactive, and I'm sure you have questions that you'd like to put to, and it's probably better if you try and put the question, if you have a specific question, to the person. But I'm going to take a number of questions, and then I'll invite responses from the panel. I see hands going up here and here, and then over on this side. Okay.
Hello, good morning, everybody, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for your presentations.
And just give your name.
I will indeed. Yeah. Anne Flynn is my name, and I work with a national social change agency called Safe Ireland, and we are working to transform culture and the response to gender-based violence in Ireland, and we're very ambitious. We want to make Ireland the safest country in the world for women and children. So my question is really about leadership, and I suppose it's addressed to you all, and particularly to you, Jenny, because we have recently got funding from the Community Foundation for Ireland, which has dramatically changed the way that we are able to do our work and the way that we're going to be able to transform the response to gender-based violence in Ireland. So it's really about how do we influence decision makers to take leadership positions on these roles. And you mentioned, Nancy, just in relation to the importance of power and leadership to make decisions, but we need leadership at all levels if we are to meet the objectives of this particular goal. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think there was another hand on that row, yep. And then I come to this side.
Hi, my name is Amelia Sef, and I work in the voluntary sector. This is a question for Geraldine in particular. In the context of what you presented, what do you think is the role of the African diaspora, and particularly women, African women, and the youth and the young diaspora?
Thank you very much. Now, there were two hands on this side that I saw, yes, here in the front row, and then two behind. Not in the front row, the third row.
Hi, my name is Carrie, and I work for the Human Dignity Foundation, which is a foundation based here in Ireland that funds projects mostly in Africa. And we work for, our mission is all people and children living with dignity. And my question is particular to Heather. And I just wanted to see if you can comment on the role that donors have, all different types of donors in the sector, and how donors have a role in allowing for implementing partners to make mistakes and to learn from not meeting targets necessarily, particularly when it comes to gender equality, which takes years to make transformative change, and on objectives that are not necessarily measured by strict quantitative indicators, when strict results-based frameworks seem to be becoming the gold standard in securing funding from bilateral, multilateral donors and ODA. So,
thank you for that question. I saw a few heads nodding as you were spelling that out. So, yes, this will be the last one of this round, and I'll invite responses, and then I hope we'll have time for another round.
Good morning. My name is Mary Heshen. I'm from Sir Optimist International. One of the things that each of you mentioned this morning was around accountability. And the dreaded words due diligence came up, which is a wonderful idea. It was mentioned largely in New York at the CSW by the World Bank, for instance. But I wonder how that translates down on the ground. Due diligence is fine, it's paper-based, very clear outcomes. But many of our projects, I think, are delivered by people who may not be just as at that level of delivery, you know, that level of accountability. And I wonder what plans there are to translate that for people who are actually working on the ground. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, well, can I invite, starting with you perhaps, Noeline, and then Heather, and then Geraldine, to respond, and don't take the questions that were specifically.
I think I would take the last question about due diligence. And it is so unfortunate sometimes that what it usually means is bureaucratization of the funding process. I'm so sorry to kind of say that. And it makes it so difficult, so that for the little drips and pieces you get, the amount of work that these grassroots organizations have had to put in order to be accountable. I am sometimes worried, how come we are not holding that type of accountability to the big players, but to the little, small NGOs in the community and so on? And I think that somehow we need to make that easier so that they can get the work done and hold due diligence where it's supposed to be. So that is just a thought, because I fully understand, and I have to tell you the UNIFEM crisis that I spoke about earlier came in because originally, before we had all this big funding for women's organizing, UNIFEM was a funder of women's organizing at the ground level. From the time of the first executive director to the second, I was the third. And most of these women at the ground level, they were so busy doing all kinds of stuff, they didn't track as well as they should. And of course, that's not the excuse. And eventually, we have to train them. But at the same time, I think we need to really build that type of capacity, but not make it so bureaucratic that it is just impossible to get the work done. I think the other question that I will talk about very quickly is the one about power and leadership. And if the SDG is a transformational agenda, as is the Beijing platform for action and so on, we also have to think what constitutes transformational leadership.
And transformational leadership is not just at the top, it is at all levels of society. And it's that collective leadership that makes a big difference. And how do we facilitate that to close divides so that it is transnational, it also goes from the top to the bottom to the top, so that there is a collective leadership that moves this agenda forward in terms of collective power. So I just would like to say that power has to be understood differently so that it is more shared, but at the same time, it has to be based on collective values and collective vision.
Thank you, Nolene. Heather?
Well, ditto on those two responses. In addition, just to say on the due diligence, I agree on that. There's an interesting article called Effective Philanthropy that was written by a woman named Caroline Fain at the University of Chicago, and she talks about the concept of the net grant. When you subtract from the grant you get the amount of time, the value of the time that you spent raising the grant and then reporting on the grant and all of that, sometimes you actually have a negative net grant, or at least a very small one. On this question from the Human Dignity Foundation, I really agree. I think there has been a huge, there's the pendulum is swinging back now, but the pendulum swung so far to this issue of measurement, kind of slavish measurement, and people wanting everything to be extremely quantified. The whole effort to use randomized control trials for a wide range of social change issues that made it onerous for a lot of grantees. But also, the philanthropy sector loves to say, oh, we have patient capital, oh, we have risk capital. And actually, the philanthropy sector too often is neither patient and risk averse. So I agree with you. I think that the conversation, the pendulum is shifting back again, thank goodness. I think that there's a huge conversation that's going on that I'm a part of in both the US and Europe, and I'm trying to bring that into conversation I have with philanthropists in emerging markets in India, China, and elsewhere, to say that the kinds of changes that we know make a difference, we agree on the changes we want, they will not happen overnight, and there has to be more allowance for grantees trying things and failing. We all try things and fail, and we learn better from that. So I think you're really onto the right thing, and I have some hope that it's infecting the sector.
Good. Thank you. Geraldine?
Thank you. I'll start with a question on the diaspora, and I want to deal with it in two ways. Firstly, the African Union, especially in pre-summit meetings, have the involvement of the Women's Diaspora Network. So there is a structure at the geographic global level through the AU, the political body itself. And I think you should get more details and get involved in it. And they get involved in very specific issues. Over the past 3 years, their focus has been women in agriculture and in the agriculture value chain as a whole. They've also looked at women and gender-based violence, and this has been consistent. This year has been declared the year of women's, of Africa's women's human rights focus, so there's that focus on it. And I think it's the moment to come in. And then, of course, the whole peace conflict agenda, the work that Mary has done, and what's there. The second part I want to deal with is more national, so I'm really just glossing over it. But in a previous incarnation, I was Minister for Public Service and Administration in South Africa in two consecutive terms. And at one point, we were looking very much at the nexus between the public, private sector, and civil society through organized labor, because we were looking at the broader needs for the South African economy. And the one issue that we were trying to look at very closely was South Africans and Africans in the diaspora with skills in sectors that were required for the economy, and looking at the brain gain, not only for people to come back, but if, for example, you're based in NASA, how do you come back and spend a period of time, a year or every 2 years, and feed back and build capacity nationally? And I think that's more broadly. I think Asia's had examples as well with the diaspora and so on. Because democracy also guarantees discontinuity, with the change in the political party, that I'm from and all, and with the new administration, there were some challenges. But I think the idea is still there, and we need to look at how we make linkages between global goals, regional goals, and looking at the national development plans and the linkages from the diaspora with that, but a greater discussion. A second and last issue that I'd want to talk about, and it's the whole accountability thing. In terms of where I'm located now, due diligence is a huge issue for us. But coming back to the example I made around the affirmative financing action for women in Africa, the reason that we have a strong technical component that we've built in is precisely to support women as they need to prepare proposals that will be bank ready. Now, here we're not talking about the small amounts. You're talking about women coming in for much larger amounts of money. So I think to a large extent, where there's this demand as well, and avoiding the bureaucratization, and fortunately this move back to taking into account that you can't narrow this down, we also need to invest in building capacity. And it shouldn't, it must be grant funds made available. And this is where we also want to talk with the players in the private sector who has a corporate social responsibility and other funds.
Great, thank you, Geraldine. I know there's at least one more hand. I think we can take probably two more. Three, because I've seen that. Quick questions, and we'll get some quick answers, and then, yeah, okay, please.
Thanks, Shelley Dean, from the advisory. Thank you very much.
Wait for the mic, please, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Hi, Shelley Dean, Brehan Advisory. Thank you very much for the presentations. It struck me that you mentioned risk, and it was the first time we heard risk in between yesterday and today. It seems to me that while we're sharing knowledge today, and it's incredibly useful to hear women talk about finance, because it seems to be the issue that the money issue is the one that women don't talk about, particularly in donor funding and securing money. But perhaps there's a need to reframe the argument around shared values and shared risk, so that donors acknowledge public and private partnership donors acknowledge that there's a reality around the shared risk as well as the shared value that everyone sees, if not in current investment, then future investment and profit from whatever kind of work that we try and do. So I think reframing the argument around mutually shared knowledge, risk, and value might be a way to start changing the infrastructure around donor aid and the due diligence and accountability we discussed earlier. Thanks.
Good, thank you very much. And then two here, yep, the two hands that are up there.
Thank you. My name is Sorli Mackay, and I am speaking later, so I'm going to keep this very brief. A lot of the discussion around the SDGs is necessarily around how we're going to fund them. And there is a significant funding gap from the estimates that have been made. And a lot of the focus is on really kind of tapping into the flow of private capital, global private capital, almost to the detriment of the more human rights and accountable sources of finance that are already there. So I'm wondering just in general, what your concerns are around this focus on private global capitals, which haven't to date demonstrated any significant development outcomes from previous investments. So what do you think is going to change if they are the place that we need to go to fund the SDGs?
And just pass it behind you. Yep, thank you.
Hello, my name's Bronwyn Winter. I work at the University of Sydney in an area that could very broadly be described as transnational feminism and feminist international relations, but I do a lot of other things in relation to the state. And I'd actually like to bring the state back into the picture a little bit here, because when we talk about due diligence and the sorts of things that Nolene were talking about, where these very small NGOs, women's services and so on, that are competing for these very tiny grants and have to do this incredibly bureaucratic reporting, I don't think that's accidental. I think it's quite deliberate. And I think governments, and I've seen it happen in Australia, I've seen it happen in many countries in the world, I think governments are actually actively penalising NGOs that are working for people's rights. They're defunding them. The first women's refuge created in Australia in Sydney is now run by a Christian organisation because it was put out to private tender, and Christian organisations have been winning the bids quite a lot in Australia, so a lot of those sorts of services, legal aid, Indigenous services, women's services, and so on. And these incredible reporting requirements that women's services in particular are suffering from because they get very little money to start with, I think it's deliberate. We also talk about making corporations accountable. We forget that corporations aren't just sort of out there in the stratosphere beyond governments and the power of governments. Governments are actively legislating in favour of corporations. We saw what happened with the bailing out of the banks. That could have been done quite differently, yes. Like in Iceland, there was actually greater regulation of banks after the crisis there. So we can do these things differently. Governments can do these things differently. So while we're talking about making corporations accountable, we also have to talk about making the state accountable and building civil society networks that work to do that. Thank you.
Okay, who wants to lead off now in responding? Well, I'll call on you, Heather, this time. Yes.
Okay. I think just maybe I'll answer the question about the private sector. First, I think, and building a little on the last comment, I think that what governments are supporting is not necessarily sufficiently promoting human rights or sustainable development. I think we have to raise the bar on the accountability of governments and the UN system, which I don't think emphasizes human rights enough. When it comes to the private sector, of course, it is even harder because we don't have enough mechanisms yet. I think, again, there are rays of hope, and I would point to one effort. The whole term impact investing was coined originally by the Rockefeller Foundation that was building on work that was already happening. The same foundation right now is launching an initiative to really measure the impact of impact investment because there's a lot of hype. You talk to people in the United States who are doing funding in Africa and Asia and elsewhere who say, I'm doing impact investing. If you go and look at some of the enterprises that they're supporting, some of the private schools, some of the private health facilities, they're sometimes impoverishing people or destroying systems, not strengthening them. But I think that, again, there's a move afoot to really to expand the capacity and the existence of measurements for the private sector. And I do think that if we don't build that in from the beginning, now in 2016 and 2017, we will never reach the sustainable development goals because private finance has to be a part of it, but it has to be accountable and measurable results from that private finance. Thanks.
Good. Noli?
I like the last comment extremely much, and I think you are right on. And I want to put that in the context of the fact that there is the closing of democratic spaces in so many of our societies. And this is happening at a time when you have the rise of extremisms, you have all kinds of threats to the gains that we have made. And we have not talk very much about that. And that is a much larger risk, if you like. There is a closing of democratic spaces in many of the countries that we have been active in. And that actually will lead to the lack of accountability or the grassroots holding the state and the private sector accountable. And this is a problem that I worry about because I see it emerging in Asia as well, and this is also emerging in the emerging economies of Asia, which is very problematic, because the gains that we have made before was because of the opening up of many of these spaces, but I would like to link that to the fact that it's because the elites that we have created have now felt that they can only maintain elite power in a particular way, and there is a transnational connection of the powerful elites. And I think that we need to rebuild the transnational connection of our people's movement and to institutionalize that in a particular way. And I'm going to end with this. One of the things that I was very proud of doing was actually to deal with CEDAW. Right. Mm-hmm. This is the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. At the Beijing conference, the CEDAW committee, whom we funded to go there, actually said to me, can you be to CEDAW what UNICEF
is the Convention on the Rights of Children. Mm-hmm. And because there's no one that was behind pushing that agenda. And the way we did it was that we actually decided, because we didn't have so much money, but we used our money in a very strategic way, and that was to institutionalize alternative reports from the civil society, from the ground up, so that at the UN is we the peoples, and we should never forget that. Mm-hmm. So the peoples should have a voice to see how the state that represents them is actually delivering for them after they have committed. Or at first there was a lot of, there was a lot of tension. And of course we were criticized for bringing the NGOs in, the civil society, in the women, in. But at the end of the day, because we train the civil society to be the advisors to their CEDAW committee so that they could ask certain questions, then they became the knowledge holder. And we increased their power and their visibility. And at the end of the day, it was amazing the change that actually happened. Some of the unaccountable governments were embarrassed, and then they relied on their civil society to clean them a little bit. And so at the end of the day, there was greater legitimacy for civil society. And I think that we need to use the multilateral system in a more clever way. And this is something that I feel very strongly about. But I don't think we have actually know how to harness the power of already the institutions that we have to make the type of change that we need to do in the world that is getting more fragmented as it is also globalizing.
Good. Geraldine?
Thank you. I think the questions and comments have been invaluable. And I think, in essence, Shelley made a comment. And I had one slide up. I tried to check. Yeah, and the slide spoke about the whole issue of women considered to be more risky, and I spoke about the issue of collateral and all that. So simply want to agree that there's got to be mutually shared risk, and that's why coming back again to using the affirmative finance action for women sort of overall ecosystem, we've got to make the argument for it. And I put it to you, do this both to us and to the UN high-level panel that's looking at the whole issue of women's economic empowerment. They should be coming out with their report quite soon, because unless we're able to provide some answers, or let me put it this way, unless we put proposals on the table, everyone is going to say to us, this is just too difficult to deal with, and we are going to create risk in the financial sector rather than taking into account the lack of accountability that's been in the financial sector that led to the crisis that was referred to earlier from the floor. And I really can't resist, Mary, but that last comment from Bronwyn and the question of state accountability, yes, yes, yes. And as one says that, and having been on different sides of the table, I think we all know it's something that we need to work on all the time, and know that even as we see ourselves in a special moment having made gains, that it doesn't mean that we can become comfortable, because at the end of the day, it's the very legal environment that will be used against us, sometimes constitutionally and legally. And at the end of the day, we have the power to change that, but it requires a large movement as well to support that where it's entrenched. Thank you.
Thank you. I know we're slightly over time, but we did start slightly late, so we'll take our 15-minute break, bearing that in mind. I just wanted to, it's often useful to have examples of trying to give a kind of leadership, and the point was made about it shouldn't be just leadership at the top. There also has to be leadership of grassroots, and they have to meet. And I just want to give an example of where we're trying to do this in the context of the climate negotiations. In Cancun, and that was when I was working in Realizing Rights, and Heather was working with me at the conference there, it so happened that even though the climate world is still predominantly a male world, women are becoming more involved at a ministerial level, but still, because it's been scientists and environmentalists and energy it's been pretty male, but that is changing. But it so happened that Connie Hedegaard had chaired the COP in Copenhagen, Patricia Espinoza was chairing the COP in Cancun, and Maite Mashaban was about to chair the next COP in Africa. So we had three women. So we kind of worked on it to persuade these three women to form a troika of women leaders and then a troika plus enlarging to ministers and then heads of agencies. Little did I know how unpopular the word troika was going to be here. I actually tried to get the women leaders to change the name. And no, they said, no, we like it. You know, it's our brand. So, but we had this troika of women leaders, and we were successful, as I mentioned briefly, in getting gender balance into the delegations going to the conference in the future, that gradually they would have to be more gender balanced, and into the institutions like the Green Climate Fund, etc. And it's slowly beginning to happen, and the secretariat of the UN FCCC has to report on this, so there's a measuring and accountability. And now, the next stage for the Troika, and we've decided this at a meeting in April, is to get grassroots women into the, actually into the negotiations, into the delegations, so that we can really, and we did a little bit of this with my Foundation on Climate Justice in Bonn at the last meeting. We brought two superb grassroots women, one from the Philippines and one from Kenya. And they participated in the discussions of the work program on women, which is being reviewed. There was a work program instituted in Doha at the time of the Doha Miracle on gender balance. There was also a work program agreed upon. And it's being reviewed now. And the review is, they agreed, because they heard these grassroots women, that one of the things they should try to have in the review is the participation of grassroots women in the delegations as much as possible and in the actual formal meetings. Because what happens is we have more and more grassroots women funded by you know, the Global Fund, and there's a Green Grassroots Women's Fund, etc., to come to where conferences on climate are taking place, but they're not at the conference itself. I mean, in Paris, I actually went into the center of Paris. The COP itself was out at Le Bourget, and I was out there most of the time. But the grassroots women couldn't get to it. So I went into Paris to speak to a whole vibrant group of grassroots women who were kind of trying to influence, but miles away from where the decisions were being taken. And the reason why it's so important is these are the women who deal every day with building resilience, with adapting, with understanding the impacts. And they have a huge wisdom, but it's not getting into the system. So I just wanted to mention that, because I think examples help. This is work that has to be done, you know, rigorously and, you know, really trying to make it happen. So it is a little bit after. It's 25 past now, so I suggest that we try to, I think we better be nice to people and say, but we will start, the next session will start sharply at 1:45. So be here in your seats for it to start sharply. And I do have to say, this was a wonderful panel. And actually, the questions from the floor were very good. Yeah. So clap the panel and clap yourselves.